Good afternoon. Let me thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity on this very important occasion of 70 years of economics department in Salamis. Well, I am not going to have a very lengthy introduction of the speaker, not because time does not permit me, but I think the speaker does not need an introduction to Chennai. For years, she was with us in Chennai at the Madras Institute of Development Studies. Her research has a broad spectrum in terms of political institutions to conceptualizing this whole process of development. So I think that's a very, very broad spectrum of research and writings which Professor Manabi Majumdar has produced over her illustrious career, both in the Madras Institute of Development Studies as well as now in Kolkata. So I'm not going to read out the CV and then make you all boring. But before I hand over the session to the speaker, couple of comments on the session as well as its importance. Well, first let me start about its importance. The empty chairs in the back actually shows how important children are. Because when we talk about the financial sector or about trade of in the economy or about macroeconomic policies, we can see a really packed house with a lot of students trying to find out what will be the possible rate of inflation after the budget, etc., etc. But I think when we really talk about development process, we have to bring children to the center of the discussions. And that is exactly what this session is trying to do. And that is exactly what Professor Manabi is trying to do. Now, three reasons for me to be very, very interested in this whole discussion. A, we are in an era when we are talking about inclusion in the growth / development process. Initially, we talked about equitable growth, but we thought that equity is a very difficult word to conceptualize in economics and things of that sort. So we'll have more inclusive growth. Then we made it, well, inclusive development process. But then when we talk about this inclusiveness in both growth / development, we have to be clear in terms of whom are we trying to include, what are the broad parameters on which we want to include people. And it is in that context perhaps children are the ones which are in the periphery, both in terms of the parameters which we look at as well as in terms of the subjects of this inclusion. So I think there's an important task for us in bringing children back to the discussions. B, there is also a lot of discussions on the rights of children now, and that I think precisely what the speaker is going to address today, so I am not going to talk about that. But when we talk about these rights, then we also need to understand what are we really emphasizing. Yeah, because we are actually in an era where individual rights, social rights, group rights, all these come into conflict when we look at certain important issues in terms of social development. So I think the second major kind of an issue for me is this whole understanding of rights of children, which I'm sure the speaker is going to dwell upon at length. Third important thing is that we as a nation have to start worrying about childhood. Yeah? I'm sure in the best universities across the world, there is a separate department called early childhood studies. Here we club it along with education. Yeah? Early childhood is not education alone, there is more than that. So we have to start thinking in terms of what this childhood really means from children's perspective, so that we can imagine or conceive a childhood which could be free from deprivations as well as distress. So with this very brief kind of an introduction, may I now request the speaker to deliver the talk. Thank you so much.
Dear Professor, Department of Economics, to felicitate our guest speaker, Dr. Manabi.
Suresh Babu and all of you. Let me begin with expressing my heartfelt gratefulness to the organizers of this conference and the academic fraternity at Stillamaris College for giving me this opportunity to be part of this August gathering. You know, since morning I have been here and I have been thoroughly enjoying the discussions, and above all, I am enjoying the energy, or actually drawing energy from the energy and vibrance of the students here. You know, that they have really been asking questions, helping us. So I am really, really grateful to you. Now, the title of my talk today is Centering Children in India's Development Debate, Social Choice and Collective Voice. I begin with the first order question, and that is about what is to develop and sustain? What are we after? What is the object of development? Of course, this is a vast canvas, and I cannot try to shed light on all aspects of this multidimensional question. So, I would like to focus on one key element of the development debate, and that is social development. To me, one of the primary objectives of development is to expand the boundaries of social development. Of course, there is economic development, political aspects of development, but if you ask me, then I will focus on expanding the horizons of social development. Now, social development, of course, itself is a loaded notion. We may have the idea of health, education, equity, gender neutrality, things like that, but it could be much more. For example, abolition of the caste system would also be very much part of our social development. You know, Dr. Ambedkar talked about this caste system and its, you know, entrenched inequalities associated with it, and he described it as the monster that crosses our path. So, to eliminate the negative effects of the caste system, that would also be very much a part of this social development. Similarly, expanding or deepening democracy, you know, empowering people's political power and democratic voice, that would also be very much a part of expanding the horizon of social development. So, I would work with this notion of social development being at the center of development, and within that broad rubric, I will talk about children's development and children's rights. The first slide. The first one, please. Yes. Now, but you may very well ask me, why focus on children? Isn't it the case that there is a global focus on children's rights? As the chairperson has already alluded to this importance, isn't there already a global focus? There are networks, advocacy groups, international funding for children's rights and, you know, child development and all of that. And these international agenda also has an influence on national agenda. And there is some kind of a pressure on our country to respond to the concerns of global image making. You know, we are going to be a shining India. So, we need to then also address some of these global concerns. So, it seems, it may be argued that there is already a global focus. Children are already at the center of developmental debate. Why am I trying to suggest that children are removed from the developmental debate that is currently dominating Indian political and economic climate. Indeed, this global focus on child rights and children's rights are viewed skeptically. You know, there is a lot of skepticism about these global agenda for various reasons. You know, it is argued, and you know, there is a criticism made that this kind of global agenda actually tends to mold childhood in a single caste, as if there is one homogeneous childhood, as if there aren't multiple childhoods. And also there is a concern that in the name of having a lot of concern and supervision and control on children by the adults, children's freedom is being infringed. You know, I mean, these days people talk about helicopter parents. Helicopter parents who are always hovering above the head of the children. They're always, you know, taking care of children. So, this excessive adult control, is it not infringing on children's freedom and rights? Now, it is true that many of these child development related schemes and welfare programs and conceptions underlying these programs sometimes imprison children rather than free them. It's also true that many of the promises of such programs have been belied and betrayed. Even then, I think in my view, and many people actually make such arguments, in my view, the promises of expanding the boundaries of inclusion, the inclusion of into social opportunities for millions of children, those promises are very real. The possibility of avoiding avoidable predicaments, the predicaments which are avoidable, premature death, you know, innumeracy, illiteracy, these are avoidable predicaments. Now, the possibility of avoiding these avoidable predicaments is very real for these children. So, in my view, as a result, there is still a need for, you know, foregrounding the plights or the case of deprivation of a large number of children in our country. And that is why, you know, the emphasis on, that is why the stress on bringing children at the center of developmental debate. Now, for example, you know, the chairperson has already again made a reference to this, and this is about early childhood. You know, it is said, it is argued, scholarly research clearly establishes that first 6 years are extremely important in anybody's life in determining a child's attitude, opportunity, health and well-being. It is important for a child to have some kind of support in order to be emotionally stable, socially competent, cognitively able and physically healthy. If we think about cognitive, physical, social and emotional development of children, then it is not enough that parents come forward. It's true that at one level, parents are best placed to take care of children. There is no doubt about that. But we need not be forced to choose between, you know, parental care and social support. Now, when I talk about, let's say, social support, we can think about social support or even intervention at two specific levels. One is some kind of support and commitment that may address the structural inequalities, the problems of poverty, discrimination, and the structural roots of inequalities. And the other more immediate intervention could be in the form of, you know, various kinds of schemes that address the needs, the welfare and well-being needs of children. And on this count, India's record is very poor. India's record is very poor. You know, for example, a World Bank report 2012. Of course, I know that National Family Health Survey report also survey has, the results have come out. But even with some progress, India is not one of the shining countries as far as infant mortality, lowering of infant mortality rate is concerned. You know, as late as 2012, out of the 194 countries, 150 countries, that is 77% of the set of countries considered, infant mortality rate was lower than what it was in India. And not only is the case that we are not doing very well in terms of infant survival, the progress, the rate of progress is also quite sluggish. So it is not that India has actually given, India's development debate has given a lot of focus on children's well-being or children's issues. And children remain out of focus. They're doubly removed from developmental concerns and debates because they are voiceless, and because in many a case their parents are also voiceless. So, you know, when we are talking about child deprivation, it's sort of a double jeopardy, because parents also, some families, they suffer from deprivation, and their children are also voiceless, both at the social level and within the family. So my argument submission is that it's not possible to, or it is not advisable to subsume the issue of children's deprivation within the larger debate of household poverty. Of course, household poverty and discrimination can partially address this issue, but we have to decompose this problem, and we have to also separately, individually address the questions of children's welfare and well-being. And, you know, there was this focus study called Focus on Children Under 6 that was done in 2006. And what they did a survey or an analysis of parliamentary debate and media coverage. And, the media coverage, comparing different kinds of, news reports, and it was found that foreign direct investment received as much importance as child health, child education, child well-being combined. Even in parliamentary debates, political parties did not, spend a lot of time talking about children's issues. So they are, in a sense, voiceless, and that's why there is a need to center them, bring them at the center stage of developmental debate. Next slide, please. But at the same time, I would like to draw your attention to the fact that India is a kind of a continent-like country, with the states like country-like states. So India is differently developed. Even within India, there are huge differences in terms of child well-being and deprivation. So there is a scope for learning by India from India. There is a scope to learn from within India, and to raise this and answer this, try to answer this question as to how come that children, young children, are enabled in some states of the country, but they are disabled from doing so in other parts of the country. It sort of brings us to focus on these social, political, economic parameters, the nature of democratic politics itself, to find out or to try to answer why are some states relatively dormant in terms of achieving, you know, child development, whereas other states are relatively more active. You see, here what I have done is I have of course picked up only a set of states, and there are a few which are, you know, I call active states, and there are, you know, then there is India, and then there is a set of states which are relatively dormant. And this is a kind of, this is actually an index called Child Development Index. It is, you know, calculated by Professor John Reyes and Ritika Khera. And these actually, these indices are an average of child immunization, female child literacy, and proportion or share of children who are not underweight. And you see that two time periods are covered, 2005-06 and 2013-14. Of course, drawing on two separate sets of data. So, these figures perhaps are not comparable, but ranks are comparable for individual time period. And you see that in both these cases, the states which are forging ahead, the leaders, they keep forging ahead. They retain their ranks. Whereas the states which are standing still, so it's not only the case that there are laggard states, but also the case that these states are not doing very well. Their democratic politics, their political regimes are not really very sensitive and attentive to this whole, predicament of children in their own respective states. But the point is, that's why I think that it's important to learn from within India about how come what works in some states but does not work so well in some other provinces of the country. Now, so as I have explained to you, that this is the topic or subject which is extremely important in a developmental discourse. And I have also referred to some of the skepticisms or criticisms about focusing on child rights that people have come up with. But when they focus on, they level the charge that, you know, we are homogenizing or essentializing childhood, I would say that there should be a little more focus on unequal childhood. And that is what I would like to focus on in my next slide. And that is, you see, this is about, suppose we are given, as you students, you are given a task of preparing a map of unequal childhood. You know, is it possible to prepare a map of unequal childhood? Here I would like to draw your attention to some of these, you know, individual issues that I have listed here. And if we would like to develop such a map, would be really constrained to do so, because there is almost a kind of epistemic void. There is a huge knowledge gap as far as mapping or charting out unequal childhood is concerned. Similarly, there is what I have borrowed this phrase, statistical form. It's about, you know, a lot of inadequacies, you know, lot of intransparencies when you talk about unequal childhood. Now, you know, very recently there was an interview with Mr. Bezuara Wilson, who is one of the leading members of this Safai Karmachari Andolan, that is the manual scavengers movement, and he has, you know, made these very serious observations that when he was growing up as a child, you know, his experience, his lived experience of belonging to a family of manual scavenger. You see, of course, now the Supreme Court has banned this practice. It is true that there are officially no dry latrines. But the state itself, in a sense, you know, reinforces this practice, because in many municipalities all over India, there are no systems of mechanical emptying of pits. So underground sewer lines and septic tanks are most of the time cleaned by human beings. Where, you know, suppose there in an area there are 5 lakh people, then there is supposed to be 50 machines, suction machines for cleaning sewer lines and you know, septic tanks. And according to the survey findings from this organization, on an average there are 2 or 3 machines for the municipalities, and this work has been contracted out to various contractors, and they employ human beings. And he says, when he was growing up as a child, that, and on the basis of his experiences, he claims that nobody, absolutely nobody, can be happy cleaning human waste. So, but there are, you know, if you want to, they have done some surveys, they have done, come up with some statistical figures, but if you really want to ask, you know, or find out about the living reality of children from these families, practically nothing is available. This issue itself is, you know, and he is asking this question, if it is a question of technology, you know, remember that through apps and all that, we can now deliver food at our doorstep without any human being involved. But when it comes to the question of cleaning pits, septic tanks, there no technology has been developed. You see, this question we have to address when we are involved in debating about development. Why is this, you know, is it a rocket technology or science that we are talking about? And his point is that because it's a reserve of the so-called, it's a task of the Dalits, the issue of adopting appropriate technology has never been asked. It's not a concern. So, I mean, we have to be exercised about these issues. You know, I mean, why is that technology not developed when we really have, you know, technologies for ordering food at home? Similarly, you know, there have been some studies done about these informal workers. You know, we have, I mean, these are the points that I would like to highlight and present before you for discussion and debate, because these are the things, you know, about children we don't know. We know about brick workers family, but Jan Brehman, in his study of, you know, decade long study of informal workers and on various kinds of laboring processes, what labor processes are involved in making bricks. And he has charted the life of a family, including the life of the children belonging to a brick worker family. And he is talking about this, you know, their working day lasts for about 12 to 16 hours. And it starts around 2 or 4 o'clock in the morning. And children who are below 6, they are awakened by their parents, suppose about 4 o'clock in the morning. And when a brick, when it is wet, it weighs about 3 kilograms. And a child who is below 6 has to carry one brick each at, you know, for 2 or 3 hours at night. And the child who has attained the age of 9 will carry 2. So 6 kilos of weight he will carry. So, you know, this kind of documenting of how children actually live. In poverty analysis, all this is some subsumed under, you know, or within some figures, headcount ratios and all that. But when we are talking about this laboring process, you know, these living conditions and labor, you know, working conditions, then we will realize, you know, what unequal childhood means. Similarly, you know, I here talk about this study which is done, untouchability report, that has been, you know, done by Navsarjan Trust and Robert Kennedy Center for Justice and Child Rights. And this is a study of about 1500 villages in Gujarat. And the study was on untouchability practices. And they have listed, you know, many such practices, both horizontal and vertical. You know, within the caste group, you know, across caste groups, various kinds of untouchability practices, and how these are very much still, you know, how deep these are, and what are the effects of these, and how then a life of indignity perpetuates. And within that family that is being at the receiving end, how, I mean, what is the experience of children? For example, you know, even in distributing prasadam in temples, there is this practice of throwing the prasadam in the hands of the so-called, you know, untouchable, in a manner such that onlookers can see that no physical contact was made. So, you know, this is so real, it was so intentional to establish that no physical contact has been made and the untouchables, you know, remain untouchables in that sense. So, and this has been done in 2012, you know, it's not very, you know, it's not that, you know, we are talking about a remote past. And also, you know, the point is that these are being internalized by us, by our students, by our children, so much so that we uncritically accept many of these things. For example, there was a study done where high school children were asked, you know, to define democracy. And then they very readily and very quickly define democracy as by the people, for the people and of the people. And after the conversation went on for some time, when they were asked whether, you know, people, all the children and all the residents will have access to the village well, the students themselves said no. So you see, we are internalizing many of these, you know, prejudices and, you know, and that contribute to perpetuation of unequal childhood. Then the question of, I bring up, you know, in this debate, the mundane question of toilets. Okay, it may sound like, you know, question, I mean, why do you talk about toilets in this very interesting conference? But it's very much a part of the developmental debate, you know, because scholarly research has established very clearly the strong linkage between open defecation and child survival. Child nutrition, child survival heavily depends upon this issue of open defecation. And toilets are being constructed. Toilets sometimes are, you know, constructed without paying adequate attention to the question of who will empty the pit. You know, Diane Coffey and Dan Spears, they have been doing a lot of work called immersed research. They are spending time in villages and all that to find out about toilet use. And it seems that one of the major issues is who will empty the pit. And because it's the, you know, traditional manual scavenging families that are supposed to empty this pit, and they have decided, asserted that they will no longer do that, people still continue to have the practice of open defecation. So this is also a kind of caste issue, is a very much an equity issue here. And that, you know, is sort of the technology again. And we are talking about, you know, 2018, and we are still talking about open toilet and all that. And Bangladesh actually has gone far ahead of many parts of India in this respect, because there has been some kind of political empowerment of the disadvantaged group there, and especially women. So, as an aside, I then raise this question of technology. You know, this was a very interesting finding by an Australian engineer and a professor who has done a study of water utility and sanitation utility research, and who has come up with this strange finding that water utility, electricity and sanitation related technologies, services are much more expensive in India than in many developed countries. Technology for these basic opportunities or facilities are far more expensive in India as compared to those in developed countries. And he then is coming up with this idea that technology is not just an applied science. Technology is very much a social performance. And only when good engineering, which is reacting or which is responding to many of these social deprivation, cases of social deprivation, then it is contributing to social development. So if we talk about development as social development, then we have to think of, and he is saying mobile is so cheap. Why is drinking water and sanitation so expensive? You know, this is, you see, in the morning probably many of you did hear this talk on, you know, fertilizer subsidies and all that, you know, and drinking water. But, of course, that is one major problem. But another major problem is expensive technology to provide these very basic facilities. So, I mean, good engineering will be also socially mindful, you know, socially attentive or socially responding to many of these developmental debates. Next slide. Okay. Now, you see, now I come to just, you know, very briefly focus on preschool education. You see, I'm currently working on this, so I thought that I will just, you know, in Dr. Rukmini Banerjee's talk also, we have heard about preschool and early childhood development and education. And so far, I have focused on social neglect. I have focused on children being out of focus, being removed from the center of developmental debate. But I think parallelly, we do also have to bring in the idea of social pressure of children. And long ago in the 1990s, Myron Weiner did write a very influential book called The State and the Child and the State in India. And I think there is a time has come now when we have to talk about the child and the market. Because I think the market is becoming more and more a fetish in our times, in our climate. You see, of course, it's not that market is an unqualified bad. You know, market is there with us. But if I refer to Karl Polanyi, who talked about great transformation, he did talk about a completely unregulated market. And it is a kind of an unregulated market that I think is a problem. It's not a solution to the problem. And there you see, when I talk about social pressure, of course, Dr. Banerjee very perceptively commented on the age of the child, the age of entry into school, but at the same time, she did also refer to pressure, curriculum pressure on children. And I think the social pressure on children now, you know, I have been working on these preschool children, and preschool children are already going to two schools and one private tuition center. And parents are saying that it's good that they are spending so much time, that it's good that they are not whiling away time. So as a society, the educational imagination that we are having and imbibing, that itself is becoming perverse. I mean, I'm not saying that everything is perverse, but we have to have a kind of critical engagement here when we are saying that, you know, the children, there's some kind of homogenization in our education aspirations. We are all thinking that how we can stay ahead, how our children can stay ahead of others. And that, I think, is making so much, you know, pressure on children that what is happening is that, I mean, many movies are talking about these things. I think Hindi medium, I don't know whether you have seen that movie, to get admission into good preschools, you know, in getting involved in bribing, backstage maneuvering, jugarbazi, you know, in Hindi they call it. So all kinds of illegitimate means have to be, you know, followed and employed by parents to ensure that their children get into prestigious schools and all that. This is almost becoming a social pathology. So I think when we are talking about the polar position of social deprivation, we also do need to talk about the other polar extreme where there is immense pressure. You know, so much pressure. I don't know whether you heard about this series of incidents of suicides in Kota, where there are tuition centers and where, you know, girl student committed suicide, and the note was circulated among parents by the district magistrate there, you know, appealing to parents not to succumb to this kind of cruel, you know, heartless market pressure. So, I mean, I thought that I will just bring that in also. And the next slide, please. Do I have, 10 more minutes? Okay. I don't want to sort of, you know, monopolize on time, but just 10 more minutes. And this is about, now, I titled my talk with, you know, social choice and collective voice. Now, in economics, you very well know that choice is a very much a kind of individual choice, you know. I don't know whether you are familiar with this great book called Exit, Voice and Loyalty by Albert Hirschman, where he did talk about this choice as an economistic response and voice as a political response. You know, when I don't like this brand of coffee, I just exit. I exercise my choice, and that is individual choice. I go, I opt for another brand of coffee. This is my response as an economic person. And when I am unhappy with something that the government does, I exercise my voice. So that is my, you know, strategy as a citizen. Now, here I'm talking about social choice. I'm not necessarily talking about individual choice here. Social choice, you see, of course, there is a way of looking at children, and which is a way of looking at or labeling it as the family strategy approach. You see, it's a private burden of individual families to take care of children's needs. Of course, that is true. It will be unacceptably paternalistic to say that parents do not count, parents do not matter. Parents are best placed to take care of children. That's true. But parents do need some kind of social support also. You know, Karl Marx, you know, did talk about freedom and individual freedom, and he defined individual freedom as freedom to be or to spend time with others. Freedom without others, for Karl Marx, didn't make any sense. For him, individual freedom was quintessentially a political project of making a world together. So there is this idea of parentocracy, you know. Parents are consumers. There should be consumer sovereignty. That's one way of looking at it. But remember that parents are not always sovereign. For example, people talk about school choice. They say that parents should have choice. But what about schools' choice? Schools discriminate. Schools eliminate. Even at preschool, there are entrance examinations. So it's not that choice is unconstrained. Choice is not without any social constraint. It is constrained, you know. So that is why I wish to focus on social commitment. Individual freedom is quintessentially contingent upon social commitment and social policy. That's why the charge of paternalism has to be also critically engaged in. Now, if this is a social commitment, is it, I raise this question, is this too much of a commitment? Is it an extreme commitment on the part of the state such that it becomes unaffordable? In other words, is it an overextended commitment that the state cannot actually keep? It seems like that if you look at many of the current policies now, as if children are falling off the policy radar. Why? Because ICD schemes, you know, only in last year budget, I don't know about this year, year before last, there is a 50% reduction in the budget allocated for ICDs programs, 50% reduction. Again, in, you know, midday meals and all that, you have seen, and it became so much that Anganwadi workers had to go on strike. It became a month-to-month suspense regarding whether they will get the receive the monthly payment or not. And, you know, recently John Reyes has written about this, and he asked, apparently he asked a senior officer in the finance department and said, how come that this reduction or budget cuts are falling so heavily on the burden on the, you know, shoulders of the children? And his response was that cuts were made very hastily, and we didn't actually notice this pattern, so we didn't think through. So you see, that proves my point. People in responsible positions have not thought through the effects of these budget cuts on children because they are voiceless. As if people are not hostile directly, but they are just negligent, they are just indifferent. And this indifference is tantamount to hostility and, you know, aggression, I think, or violence. Finally then, you know, democracy. Now, in the morning, there was, in this talk, you know, Professor Devarajan talked about politics being the part of the problem. Now, I think, of course, politics is to some extent part of the problem, but politics also is to some extent part of the solution. Because if you talk about democratic power of democratic debate and power of democratic action, we're not only talking about elections here, not only talking about casting vote, but what about democratic discourse, media discourse, our debate, the debate right now that we are having, you know, it's kind of a public reasoning. We are debating, having a discourse about these things, how to put this at the center stage, and that kind of collective voice. We do have to be a kind of impatient. You know, Dr. Amartya Sen talks about constructive impatience. We have to become impatient in a constructive way and think about and debate and suggest various kinds of actions. So that's why it is collective voice that I have been talking about. And so in a sense, it is then about a kind of strenuous citizenship. We may behave as consumers, but we also have to behave as citizens. And this is kind of strenuous citizenship, you know, that we will have to spend time. You know, Oscar Wilde mentioned that democracy takes too many evenings. It's true. I mean, we are not going to movies, doing this, doing that, but we have to be exercised about this kind of citizenship responsibility, and then think about constructive alternatives. And the fine, oh, okay, I mean, these were, I mean, I've forgotten about this. You see, I recently in my, you know, survey, you know, these are some of the Anganwadis where I visited, and cooking is being done in the same classroom, and this, you know, fume, toxic fume of kerosene being inhaled by children. And the other picture was about the, you know, this is about the garbage dump next to the, you know, the Anganwadi. And then, but the final, this is, and this is also a private, you know, preschool center. So it's a private, you know, the market itself is highly socioeconomically stratified. So this is all in the city of Kolkata, you know. So in this room, there are about, you know, small room, there are about 70 children. They had no proper place to sit. So market itself is socioeconomically stratified. And the final, okay, no, the final, even after this, the final slide is about, yes. So this is about, I mean, something for, you know, people hailing from Tamil Nadu. This was again a study, a comparison of Anganwadi centers. You see, that's what I'm saying, that the nature of democratic politics, You see, in a village in Tamil Nadu, there was a PhD dissertation that said that every hand pump, every street light was a result of a democratic struggle. So similarly, here you see a comparison between UP and Tamil Nadu about Anganwadi centers and mothers in UP and mothers in their perception, of course. But there is a huge difference here about the functionality of an Anganwadi center. Anganwadi center can make a difference to lives of children, you know. And this was the result. And with this, on this promising note, I just end my discussion and debate.
Because these results are coming now, so there is social pressure, and then you know, so this whole question about parental exercise and parental pressure, it's very uncomfortable because evening after I go back home, I have to sit in the nature that this is getting done fast and parental exercise or whatever. And there is a larger question, in terms of aspirations as well as the social aspirations and the parental aspirations which is being made out of the children. But there are a couple of important issues that Manabi and the lack in the presentation. One, I think that first day was quite interested by the statistical form, because now we are in the era of big data analytics and using big data to uncover so called mysteries of the economy as well as society. And it is here in this context that the importance of micro level studies become very important. And all the studies that were mentioned actually adds to the inconsistencies that one sees when you compare with this macro level data as well as micro level. It is very important to have micro level studies in terms of uncovering the economy. Secondly, I think it's the technology use. So very interesting experience which we have at IIT. So we have this annual robotic competition where we ask our students to design a big robot for some use of that. And actually, I don't know whether you're going to be interested in all robot restaurants in the city. They go and you know, the robot will come and serve you food. Our students also made a robot for many, many different use. One of the professors actually came up with the idea that why did you make a robot for cleaning? Yeah? For cleaning. So they did that. So technology comes to us, we really need to. Then we tried it as an experiment. And we found that, okay, we increase the amount that is being put for the use of this robot. Some people came forward but not very happy. The next step, what we did was that we increased the amount a little further. Then we would start to talk about it. But then they were not very happy because they can't showcase this robot. If you go in a big exhibition or can't get a commercial data or whatever, because the technology use in a commercial sense is not very high, because they are not going to use. Then there is a very important point which was a family raises here in terms of use of technology for social development will actually affect CSP data. So, of course, as I was mentioning, the notion of social development. And interestingly, there was this very sad episode that happened in India 4 months back. In a span of 90 days, 50 students from India were shot. And that's in our favor to live in a couple of years. Not for now. So there are this captive entrance examination coaching centers. And in a span of 90 days, we went to come to suicide into this entrance examination coaching centers. There's something wrong in our social culture. Something wrong in terms of our priorities as well as social valuation of things. And I think these are very important issues which have not only earlier generation, but also the present and the future generation that we deal with. So, with these observations, now I open the floor to the questions.
In any aspect, because in it, we can see that they have choice of everything, all these people like them. Something as simple as school choice. why can't more people send their students to money that education is always better? Why? Because the price is so high. In that way, there's only a minimum choice being given to them. Even the very concept of sending them to school is also an illusion. Furthermore, that idea of politicization of education itself, and then the same enforces discourse, but in my opinion, the discourse already exists in society. And this led to only further politicize that situation, and the only adds influence in the party who have interest in you, and never really partner for the solution. It only the winner is the person who presents their case the best, and it's never really the person who has the best intention. In a situation like this, where it seems like our system is working against us, and we don't really have a way out, even something as basic as language, where children are not being educated in the language they understand, but are forced to learn the language which they understand, which makes the entire system rigged against them. So it makes people seem like whatever we do, we never really go forward. So what is your solution that you have to solve?
Thank you very much for these questions and also the work that you did. See, about choice, I love the education of many people, for many people, and education. But at the same time, I also say that even more people do have some choices. They do have choices on the stage. Many of the things are not available to them, they are not before. But still, you see, even in education, now people are saying that they are also benefiting as piece of our students and using low precarious students, some of them are doing that. So, I think most choices are very costly, but still, they do have some choices and they still do have some policy also. So, I mean, you know, and they also, I mean, interacting with them, by them. Here, that they also have a you see, it's true that when we are talking about politicization, you see, I actually didn't want to use the term politicization. I would rather focus on the question of democracy, public discourse, and action. See, public action is not just public action. I mean, if you think of the right to information movement, you see, that started on a very small scale in Rajasthan. But then it did achieve, look, something which then culminated in the aspect of the Right to Information Act. Right to Information, there were actually lots of organizations. Organized not just by affluent families, but by many people from many which culminated in the Education Act. Now it is very inadequate and poorly implemented all of that. But that there is now a bigger debate could be used as a bigger discussion. So I think that yes, if you think about the political parties, now of course they have a other cost being on the right? They will talk about the other costs. But you could think about the commercial sense of delivering funds. So, we are asking in this room, 60, 70, 100 years ago, gender equity would have been such an important issue. But because of this delivering discourse, movements by women groups, and some legislative initiatives, now we talk about the problem. My grandmother never thought about PCBs to be counted on. He didn't have a computer. But we are going to do it. So I would request you to have some kind of hope. Of course you would be, critical. But that's why I said constructive. You would be critical as well as constructive. So I think, the discourse. Today, a Ram Sabha could be a classroom, could be a democratic arena also. It could be a space of activism first. So, I mean, in that larger space of public reasoning, you see, I mean, we have to also, you know, there is an epistemic element in democracy, right? We get to know things better. You see, like technology, I mean, we did talk about robotics, and I'm told by someone that printing press in Kerala is now being done by robots. So, you see, I mean, only when we debate and talk about these things, there is an epistemic role that is being played. So our views, we re-examine and examine our views in the light of technology. So in that, liberty sense, that is democracy that we are doing. And then the third one about language, I think it's a very important issue that we are talking about. And I think, again, there are many sides to the story, because you see, there are Dalit groups who are saying that English actually is a caste-neutral language. You know, so maybe it is better for us to have access to English, not at the cost of our own mother tongue. But if your generation, your forefathers could learn a foreign language, so can our children. That's one view. So I think what is important for us is not choosing one or the other. But perhaps the point is about balance in multilingualism. You see, a balance in multilingualism. Multilingualism, human beings are by nature multilingual. So multilingualism is not a major problem. It's an imbalance in multilingualism. That we are becoming mother tongue illiterates. You see, we are becoming, many a time we are becoming mother tongue illiterates because we cannot read and write in our mother tongue language. That is, of course, I think balancing, having, striking a proper balance in multilingualism should be followed in this research.
The idea of education itself is harassing. Yeah. The idea of education itself, not just the practice, you know, what we are after. I think that's what I'm saying, the epistemic thing, the democracy has, I mean, can contribute in two different ways. Conceptualizing development itself, you know. I mean, what are we after, you know? Are we after the Marxian model of having, creating a world with others? Or are we after self-seeking? You see, this is the idea of what education is, has to be cast and recast in a public forum. It is not within the space of family that people will come up with ideas, you see. There has to be debate about arguments and counter-arguments to think about what we are after. And there you see, I mean, Anganwadi centers, actually this is an important program, and in many countries in the world, the public provisioning of early childhood care is a big thing. So if that, of course, it's not the forced to be chosen to choose between private and public, but the public provisioning of early childhood care, and there you see, we have been visiting many centers, and we are pleasantly surprised that in some centers actually there are positive changes. Children are enjoying that space of freedom, that they're happy singing songs, learning to count numbers, playing with their peers. So it's not that it's all or nothing. You see, I mean, all or nothing is a very extreme situation, but the intermediate range of possibilism, I think, is a very important area. You know? What is possible? And you see, there is one way of looking at it, is transcendental. You know, the ideal is to be achieved. The other is to enhance justice. If one situation is noticeably better than the other, you know, then there is hope, right? Then there is reason to fight for that. There is reason to work for that. And there, in comparison, there are actually positive examples of Anganwadi centers, NGO run private schools, even some private schools which are not prohibitively expensive. Yes, sir.
Surrounding the guidelines and things like that.
They are sometimes forced to, you know, be involved in child labor. There is indeed a moral dilemma, but there have been studies on the activities of mapping activities of those children, and many a time it is seen that it's not that they always are involved in income generating activities. Also, there are unemployed adult people. So you see, the point is the supply side and the demand side. You know, if you argue that there is a real demand from the family side, I did mention Myron Weiner's book, and he does address many of these questions. Even in Shivakashi here, you know, he very meticulously studied how the bus was being organized by the match factory company at 4 o'clock in the morning. So it's true that poorer children are sent there, but unless there is coercive mobilization on part of some of these companies, even in Andhra Pradesh cotton, you know, plantations and all that, it is seen that yes, there is a need, but the opportunity has been provided by many companies in a very systematic manner. So that busing of children, not to take them to school, but to take them to the factory at 4 o'clock in the morning. So adult unemployed people can be employed there. Carpet industry in UP, they said that if you increase the price, 5% increase, you actually can replace child laborers by adult laborers. So there are social issues involved here too, right? One. And second is about the rights, the voice of the child, of the marginal child, the voice of the child. It's true that sometimes there is only adult imposition. Adults speaking on behalf of children. Who will be the bearer of the rights of the child? That is your question, right? Whether children will bear or there will be, agency of the child versus agency on behalf of the children. These could clash. Sometimes they do clash. But you see, Rousseau did talk about children, whether children should have, is it an age of reason? Now, children do not necessarily attain that age of reason, and there is a civilizational question here about adults working on behalf of children, not imprisoning them, but cultivating their freedom. That balance has to be maintained by adults themselves, but I think I have seen the children, even in Anganwadis, they are very keen to be part of that common exercise. You see, the point is, school is not just about counting numbers. It's to be in a place with others. Just like, you know, we come to college, and many a time they have said that, what do you remember of college? Only friendship. See, this is a public space that is sometimes less gendered than the family. So children enjoy coming to a common space, provided it's not very, hostile. So I think that children's agency and adults' agency on behalf of children, there could be some moral tensions, but not necessarily permanent. I would say there is a tension, but not necessarily permanent.
Yeah, I think I heard a well thing in YouTube.
Everybody is happy. I mean, we have the captive audience.
I thank the Manabi for this very interesting session, bringing children back to the source and also for the engaging discussions. Thank you very much. I now declare the session closed.
I'd like to take the opportunity to thank Dr. Manabi for the entire conversation and for the insightful lecture on authentic children. India's development is required to support the social service. The session through life in the past, supporting our children's freedom and their life and well being, also gave us an insight on how the children in this society are part of the social network of social service. Thank you, ma'am. We'd like to extend a heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Sunil Babu for sharing this session. He thanks his guest faculty and other delegates for taking part in today's session. We also like to thank the faculty of Shweta for her delegate. We'd also like to thank the audience for being important and attentive throughout this session. Last but not least, we'd like to thank Mr. Nila and the team for